Dr. Paul Wilkinson, the first recorded instance of Jewish people coming into this land was 1066. Can you explain briefly what happened between 1066 and 1290 when they were expelled?
1066 is the year that historians generally believe is the date when the Jewish people came to these shores under William the Conqueror. Their primary occupation was as merchants and as financiers. They became prosperous. They contributed significantly in the whole banking industry that was beginning to develop in Europe. In 1190, Richard the Lionheart, who in many respects was a protector of the Jewish people, gave them rights, gave them protection, went off to the Crusades in the Middle East. Sadly, the history of the Jewish people during this period is one of, yes, prosperity, but also one of jealousy. There's mob rioting, trying to hound the Jewish people out, and this results in one of the worst massacres in English history, the massacre of an entire Jewish community in the city of York in 1190. In 1255, a 12-year-old boy called Hugh is murdered. Who are blamed for the murder of Hugh of Lincoln, as he came to be known? The Jewish people. The English revived the blood libel accusation. And this myth, this vile myth, entered into the very heart of English literature when Geoffrey Chaucer wrote about the blood libel in one of his Canterbury Tales. Shortly afterwards, the time of the Italian bankers emerged in Europe. And so no longer were the Jewish people needed as financiers. Now the Italian bankers were being brought into the country. There was no more use for the Jewish people. And in 1290, Edward I issued a royal edict in which he called for the immediate expulsion of all Jewish men and women from these shores.
By the mid-17th century, a strong environment of millennialism had developed from a new understanding of the scriptures, with the increasing availability of the Bible in English. The vision of the apostles for the return of Christ to rule the earth from Jerusalem was being restored. Dr. Paul Wilkinson, can you explain how this developed, how this new interest in the Bible and Israel's restoration developed in England?
Well, let's go to 1382. This is the year when John Wycliffe produces an English translation of the scriptures. This is revolutionary. Never before has the Bible been translated in English. The problem is the printing revolution hasn't taken place and it's too expensive to reproduce the scriptures in English and to get it out to the common man. So 1525 becomes a pivotal year. This is the year when William Tyndale, the great reformer, produces a translation of the New Testament, and through the printing revolution, it is enabled to get out to the common English person. And in 1530, Henry VIII, then king, in his breakaway from the Roman Catholic Church that had kept the Bible hidden from the common man for centuries, he calls over from Italy Hebraists, those who are experts in the Hebrew language, to come and help him in his dispute with the Pope as he proceeds with divorce proceedings against Catherine of Aragon. Hebrew now becomes a taught subject in English universities, notably at Oxford and Cambridge. Men like John Emmanuel Tremelius are opening up the Hebrew scriptures, the Hebrew language and the Hebrew scriptures to the common man who for centuries has been so dependent upon the priest and now can read the word of God for himself, now can get to grips with the scriptures for himself. During this period, during the mid to late 16th century, you have men like Hugh Broughton, academics, scholars, who are not only Christians, not only believe in the God of the Bible, but now have the ability to study the original languages. So you have men like Francis Kett, Andrew Willett, Thomas Drax, who are now writing books dealing with the issue of Israel. The hearts of these Christian men, and it is a small, relatively small group of Christian men at the time, are being captivated by what God has said in his word concerning this Jewish nation. But there's never been any Jews in the land of England since 1290, when Edward I expelled them from these shores.
Paul, there were many interesting people who were involved in this developing theology, people like Sir Henry Finch. Can you please elaborate a bit upon their contribution?
Sir Henry Finch, a member of Parliament for Canterbury, he's a lawyer, a legal expert. He's knighted in 1616. Sir Henry Finch produces in 1621 a book that put the restoration of the Jewish people back to the land firmly on the map as far as the church was concerned. The title of that book was The World's Great Restoration, in which Sir Henry Finch spoke about the second coming, the imminent second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, who would one day set up his reign upon this earth, and in the context of the Lord's return, would bring about the promised restoration of the Jewish people, who had been scattered to all the nations of the earth since the time of the Roman Empire. One of the things that Sir Henry Finch said in his book, that there would come a day when the nation of Israel would be the head nation upon the earth. And for the monarch of England at that time, James I, this was too much. And subsequently he had Sir Henry Finch and his publisher, William Gouge, thrown into prison. The idea that there would be a restored Jewish nation to which all the other nations, including Britain, would have to one day bow down to and acknowledge as the chief among the nations was too much for James. But that book, more than any other in the 17th century, set the benchmark for Puritan Restorationism.
How widespread did this developing theology go? I mean, you said it was a small number, but did it spread throughout the country, or was it just provincial? Was it just around London, or were there people all over the British Isles, including Scotland and Ireland, who were beginning to be involved in this new theology?
During the Puritan era, which really dates from the mid-16th to the mid-17th century, the common man has access to the scriptures. And as Christians begin to engage in their Bible, a whole range of eschatologies or understanding of the end times comes out. So there is no one Puritan eschatology. We have men like Hugh Broughton, men like Thomas Brightman, Sir Henry Finch, who represent basically a remnant within the church at this time that has got to grips with the promises of God in his word and are taking literally what God says in his word concerning Israel's restoration and the return of the Lord. But the Bible is at the heart of British society for the first time. This has never been the case in any other country since biblical times, when the scriptures were placed into the hands of the people of Israel. Now England, in a sense, are the custodians of the word of God. And so this is very much a formative period when scholars, academics, theologians, bishops, the clergy are trying to understand what is God saying about these revolutionary times, and they were revolutionary times.
Now, concerning the Puritans, many of them fled at one particular point of time when they were not accepted by the establishment here. Many of them went to Holland, and there's a particular family, the Cartwright family, for instance, who went over to Holland and had an influence over there. And then there was a very interesting rabbi called Manasseh ben Israel. Tell us about the connection between those two and how Manasseh ben Israel was involved in the return of the Jewish people to the land under Cromwell.
Let's go to the year 1648. A pamphlet is written and distributed by a man called Edward Nicholas. The title of that pamphlet is An Apology to the Most Honourable Nation of the Jews, in which Nicholas calls upon his fellow countrymen, the English, to repent before God for all the crimes that England has been guilty of in terms of perpetrating the blood libel accusation, in terms of the massacre of the Jews in York in 1190, and also to readmit the Jews. And this sparks off what would become a pamphlet war, because now the English people are grappling with the question of, should we readmit the Jewish people who've been expelled from these shores since 1290? The following year, 1649, two Puritan exiles living in Amsterdam, Joanna Cartwright and her son Ebenezer Cartwright, draw up a petition which they send to Lord Fairfax back in England, calling upon the English government to readmit the Jewish people, and not only to readmit the Jews to the shores of England, but to help the Jewish people go back to their promised land, back to Eretz Yisrael, the land of Israel. In 1654, the chief rabbi of Amsterdam, Manasseh ben Israel, sends a petition over to Oliver Cromwell. This is now the time of the Protectorate, the Lord Protector, Oliver Cromwell. King Charles has been dethroned, beheaded. Now the government of England is in the hands of this Bible-believing Christian, Oliver Cromwell. And Manasseh ben Israel sends a petition to Cromwell appealing for English help to the Jewish people in Europe who have just suffered tremendous persecution following the 30 Years' War. Manasseh ben Israel sends the petition over with his son Samuel and his brother-in-law David Dormido. Oliver Cromwell is sympathetic to this petition, but it's turned down. So the following year, 1655, Manasseh ben Israel leaves Amsterdam, sails across the North Sea, lands in England, and presents his humble address to the Lord Protector Oliver Cromwell, in which he appeals for Cromwell to readmit the Jewish people back into England. And the basis of his appeal, the scriptures, the word of God, Daniel 12 in particular, in which, according to Manasseh ben Israel's understanding, the Jewish people had to be scattered to every land across the world before God would bring them back into their own land, into Eretz Yisrael. This so happened to be Oliver Cromwell's interpretation of scripture too. Oliver Cromwell was very sympathetic to Manasseh ben Israel, and in December 1655 convenes the Whitehall Conference. Right in the heart of the English nation, Cromwell draws together merchants, theologians, clergymen to discuss this whole issue. Should we as a nation revoke the edict of Edward I in 1290 and readmit the Jewish people? Some say yes. Some say we must do, because this is God's word, these are God's people, and God is going to bring his people back, and we dare not stand in the way. Others say no, fearful that the Jewish merchants of Europe would harm the English economy. And so nothing is resolved, despite Oliver Cromwell's appeal, nothing is resolved. But Oliver Cromwell unofficially revokes the edict, allowing the Jewish people to become a community again in the land of England. It won't be until 1660, when Charles II is restored to the English throne, that the Jews are readmitted officially.
Throughout this period, we've seen how the Puritans were instrumental in developing this theology of Israel's restoration and spreading it around the country, albeit from a few individuals, but it spread. What happened after the time when the monarchy was restored, the establishment? How did they view the Puritans or anything associated with the Puritans, including this theology of Israel's restoration?
With the re-establishment of the English monarchy and the accession to the throne of Charles II, really what we have is the end of the Puritan era. For a generation, an entire generation, the Lord had raised up the Puritans to revive the word of God, to bring the scriptures to the people. And not only the scriptures to the people, but God's promises concerning his people Israel, and supremely his promises concerning the return of his son, the Jewish Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ. From the mid-17th century onwards, the belief in the restoration of the Jews to Israel dies. It's put on the back burner. And we now enter in Europe a period known as the Enlightenment. This is the age of reason. This is the age when the authority of the Bible is disputed, when the miracles of Jesus Christ are disputed. This is the age of deism, when God is portrayed as this great unknowable being who has wound up the earth and left it to its own devices. We come into the 18th century. 1721, A work is produced by Joseph Perry, again focusing on the promised restoration of the Jews to the land. 1747, again a similar work by Samuel Colley. So there were still publications being produced during this period. But it is only when we come to the time of the evangelical revival, with John and Charles Wesley, George Whitefield, that suddenly the Bible and the authority of the Bible and the miracles of the Lord Jesus Christ and the prophecies and promises of God are now engaging the Christian church.
Paul, after the French Revolution began, there was a sort of a reawakening in Britain again. So what was happening inside British society in that 10-year period after the French Revolution?
What we have is the end of the Age of the Enlightenment. Now God revives his church. Now God brings his word back to the common people through John and Charles, through George Whitefield, riding up and down the length and breadth of the country, proclaiming the word of God, proclaiming the literal interpretation of God's word, which includes the restoration of the Jewish people. And one of the other men at this time who was very much instrumental in reviving belief in the restoration of the Jewish people was an Anglican bishop by the name of Samuel Horsley, one of the foremost Bible scholars of that generation. We're now in the mid to late 18th century. Bishop Samuel Horsley produces a work on the book of Hosea in which he basically denounces or exposes the great error of the most learned expositors of the Bible, who have allegorized, spiritualized the word of God and claim the promises that God gave to Israel for the church. And Samuel Horsley says, you can't do this with God's word. You can't rob Israel of her inheritance. Samuel Horsley wasn't a nobody. He was a foremost biblical scholar whom the Lord used at this particular period to revive belief in the restoration of the Jews to the land. And this is the great period of revolution in Europe. So during this period of revival, the evangelical revival or awakening as it was also known, Christians again started to write about the fulfillment of biblical prophecy. One of the most significant writers was a man called Joseph Eyre. In 1771, he produces a book called Observations on the Prophecies Relating to the Restoration of the Jews, a direct response and refutation of a work by Bishop William Warburton, in which Warburton had allegorized or spiritualized the scriptures, specifically the promises concerning Israel, and had denounced, condemned any belief that there would be a future restoration of the Jewish people. Joseph Eyre went to the Word of God. He went to Acts 1, 6 to 8, and the disciples asking the Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? And the Lord's answer, it is not for you to know the times or seasons set by my Father's authority. In other words, the Lord was implicitly acknowledging that their question was a good one. It was the right one, but this was not the time for Israel's restoration. And Joseph Eyre quoted Ezekiel 36 to 39, which he said was the longest prophecy, single prophecy in the scriptures that talked about God restoring the Jewish people, pouring out his Holy Spirit upon this nation once dead and renewing their heart and enabling them to worship him and serve him as they did in biblical times. Joseph Eyre basically listed all the prophecies, countless prophecies, one by one, in which God had said, I will restore my people. I will bring them back. I will gather them from the four corners of the earth.
What next?
On the 10th of November 1790, the rector of Sudbrook, Richard Beer, wrote a letter to the then Prime Minister, William Pitt the Younger. This was the first letter of its kind to influence British foreign policy in favour of the restoration of the Jewish people. Richard Beer believed that maybe in the will and purpose of God, remember that the world is in turmoil, Europe is torn apart by the French Revolution, this whole revolutionary climate is having a dramatic effect on society across the board and in England. In his letter, he expressed to William Pitt, the Prime Minister, that maybe he was the man that God was now raising up to restore his ancient covenant people back to the land. Because Richard Beer, like many in his day, believed that God used political means as well as religious, spiritual means to bring about or fulfill his purposes. This is what Richard Beer wrote. I hope you will endeavour to make a powerful exertion to effect this great purpose. And perhaps no man that ever trod the stage of the theatre of this world ever had such an opportunity of doing this and acting so great a part as you have on the present occasion.
After Richard Beer, other Christians came along with a similar idea. Who were these people and what were they promoting?
1792, James Bisshaino, a Baptist minister, produces a pamphlet entitled The Signs of the Times, trying to make sense of what is going on in the world, specifically in Europe, in the aftermath of the French Revolution, which broke out in 1789. 7 years later, he writes another pamphlet, The Restoration of the Jews, in which he says that the promised restoration of the Jewish people from the four corners of the earth had not been fulfilled when the Lord brought them back from Babylon, when only 42,000 Jews returned to the land. Bisshaino and men like George Stanley Faber, James Hatley Frere were turning to the Word of God. They were turning to the books of Daniel, Revelation, Ezekiel, Jeremiah, all the prophets, predicting that these events, tumultuous events that were taking place in Europe, were signs, perhaps the signs that the Lord Jesus Christ himself gave to his disciples, that his return was imminent, and also that the restoration of the Jews was at hand.
Okay, so explain in brief then, what was the theology of the Wesley brothers, for instance, concerning the restoration of Israel?
Now, it's not particularly clear where John and Charles Wesley stood eschatologically, what their understanding of the end times was, although from Charles Wesley's hymns, there is a definite indication that he believed in the premillennial return of the Lord Jesus Christ. In other words, that Jesus was coming back soon, coming back to this earth to establish his reign upon the earth from Jerusalem. And within the context of that reign, Israel would be restored.